is Black History Month, and our next guest has done her homework, taking us back to the beginning of so many of the historical fashion trends that are actually still current today. We welcome back fashion expert and personal stylist, Robin Allen is here.
Hi.
Hi, happy Black History Month.
Happy Black History Month. I'm so excited to talk about this.
This is something I've been waiting for. I've been dying to put on my dashiki.
Yes, dashiki.
Dashiki'd out.
Well, you look fabulous, and that royal color of purple, perfect.
Thank you very much.
So I did do my homework. That was a perfect word because I wanted to get it right with the history of fashion through African American eyes.
Yes.
And the inspiration that we've gotten from Africa.
Yes.
That has come
to the motherland.
Yes. So let's get started because I really wanted to hit on a couple main topics. I'm not going to hit on it all because we don't have time for it, but I did want to hit on a couple of them. And the first one that I thought was super important, Trey, was head wraps.
Yes, we're going to start with the crown.
Yes, and we're going to start way, way back.
This is way back.
And I wanted to kind of show the history and then kind of pull it forward to the modern version of what we do now.
Okay.
The top picture is a picture of slaves back in the day and them wearing that traditional head wrap that came actually originally from royalty in Africa. Is who wears head wraps.
Really?
But when it was brought to America, it became a slave owner's requirement that the slaves had to cover their hair or make it look Caucasian. So, of course, they opted out for a head wrap because they were working so hard in the sun.
Exactly.
So that's how it came to be in America. So definitely a different stigmatism altogether
than what Africa had. Royalty to a protective device.
Exactly. And to also, going with this picture, to keep people of color in their place or to keep them identifiable within the community. So in Louisiana, the governor at the time made a law that any Creole, biracial, which I am, and any...
I'm Creole.
Creole, so
I understand.
Right there with you, sister. And then also just Black people who were free at the time needed to be recognized, and so they required them to wear a head wrap.
Wow.
Now, what they did, though, was they did a spin on it and decided, oh, yeah, you want us to wear a head wrap? That's fine. Let's do pins and brooches, and let's paint it, and let's make it elaborate and fabulous. And so you see right here, this girl's wearing a hat on top of her head.
On top of the, love it.
So they just took it and made it their own and made it important. And then this is Hattie McDaniel in Gone with the Wind.
Yes.
She was the first Black actress to win an Academy Award.
Yes.
So great job to Hattie, but also this is, again, portraying that role of mammy or slave at the time in Hollywood, even in the early ages. But we're flipping it because then what happens through history is on our next slide, hopefully we'll see this coming
about. There we go. Now this is what I'm more familiar with.
Yes, and this was basically entertainment music took on the head wrap as a very proud, powerful statement coming back to our culture. You see in Lauryn Hill, Erykah Badu, even Diana Ross and Mahogany wore those beautiful head wraps, Alicia Keys. So you saw it a lot in music and movies, and that's who was kind of bringing it to light at the time.
Trendsetters.
Total trendsetters.
Yes.
But then now, in our next slide, we're going to just see how it's kind of popped off everywhere with everyone, with anyone who can tie and wrap it, and it's just beautiful, and you can embrace whatever shade you are and whatever culture you are. So that's what the head wrap has come to be, which is beautiful.
I love it. So, and I have often tried to do this, and it takes skill.
It does take
to
skill.
Get your head wrap right.
It does take skill. So that's what's going on with the head wrap. Now, on to bold jewelry.
I love jewelry.
Which I don't know. Are we bold jewelry girls?
I don't know. I can't ever tell.
So.
Anyone notice any jewelry happening here?
Yeah. So with jewelry, actually, 75,000 years ago was the first piece of jewelry that has been discovered.
75,000
years? Yes, in South Africa. Wow. And it was these shells, which are called cowrie shells. Mm. And basically, it was a symbol of fertility and feminism, and they were done in necklaces and bracelets, and that was the first time you saw it. And organically, jewelry was made because you either caught an animal and wanted to show off that you caught it with the bone,
sure,
or with shells, or with hide from animals. So again, it was all natural. And then going into the next slide, we see kind of a progression of what it comes to be, which is with beads.
Love beads.
Yes.
And I used to rock beads in my hair when I was little.
I
No. Just clinging on along, cling, cling, cling.
And it's such a powerful statement. Again, unfortunately, it had the trade quality of trading for slaves and trading.
Oh, that's the historical significance for beads. I didn't know.
But at the time, African community took it and turned it on its head once again to be powerful and a statement through history. But what's cool about the beads is that there's messages and meaning to every piece of jewelry in African culture. And by the way, there's 54 countries in Africa and 3,000 tribes.
Right.
So it's all just one
thing.
It's
not all the same.
Yeah,
exactly.
I'm showing one example of what a tribe does. And if a triangle's up, it's a girl. If you're a diamond, you're a married woman. It also calls to gender, how many children you have, how many unmarried sisters you have. It's
all that by
shown in your jewelry.
Beads?
Yes. Yes.
Wow.
It's communication is basically what's going on. And the same with the color. Like, if there's purity, it's a white bead is purity, black is community, and it goes on and on from there.
Sure.
So it's pretty powerful and impressive. Let's see some examples.
Wow. Well, I can't tell. Well, there's a lot going on. I can't tell all the messages
that
are coming
through. This is a lot of communication.
I'm trying to read what they're putting out, but I can't get it all.
Right. But this, again, is just a beautiful example of how you embrace that darkness from where the bead culture came from into the light of tribe and community and power
Love
and spirituality.
That.
Yeah.
I didn't
so
know
So it's pretty
that.
Awesome.
All right. So now can we talk fabrics?
Yes. We're going to get to fabrics.
Oh, well,
this is just one more thing about...
Well, this is powerful.
Yes. This is the current version of how our beads are being interpreted, but then also bejeweled. We know our little Lupita over there who's just rocking it. She's Kenyan. This is the king of Ghana doing it all up.
I see.
And
a whole lot.
Yeah. So this is just a modern version of keeping the beads alive. But yes, let's talk fabric.
Okay. Oh, wait. I hear hoops are coming out.
Oh, yeah. Let's talk about
hoops.
Yeah. We can talk hoops.
So there's the origination of hoops.
Yes. So this woman right here, though, is from the Fulani tribe. Now, these gold hoops in the Fulani tribe are a major thing. They can come up to 5 inches big, and they were a nomadic tribe. They originated in Nigeria, but were nomadic, and so they wore their worth on their jewelry so they could trade
as they moved
across the country. Now, going into more current times with the beads or with the hoops is all of our girls.
I love it.
Like, if we need to know all these women and what they've done for us in entertainment and culture. But again, you see the hoops being used in many different facets, from entertainment of Josephine Baker all the way to Janet Jackson, who's using them very powerfully in that movie.
Yes, this is so good.
Yeah.
And she's coming to town.
And she's coming to town. And it goes hand in hand with the natural hair culture, hoops does, and the afro and that sensibility that came into the 60s and 70s for that black is beautiful.
Absolutely.
Kind of came hand in hand.
Okay, now can we talk fabric?
Yeah, let's talk fabrics.
Okay.
Let's go to fabrics. So, the beginning of fabrics. This is our original king of Ghana. We saw the current one a couple slides ago, but this is our original guy. And these are the fabrics they wore. This is royalty. This is how royalty looked and how it felt in the fabrics. And then if we move on into the future of fabrics, then we're going to see more of the meaning and patterns and the colors. This is kente cloth.
Yes.
And it's all woven. Unwaxed, and everything has purpose and meaning within this woven fabric. And you can see here, like, gold, royalty, wealth, spirituality, purity. That hasn't gone anywhere. That still feels the same with all these meanings. So it's very powerful what's going on in this fabric. If you wear kente cloth, please know what it means to wear it.
And that's a big one, because I think even in college, I wore kente cloth.
Right.
Not fully understanding what
the
I had on, but
it.
I knew that I wanted to represent my African heritage.
Yes.
And I just strolled through with the bright colors.
Yes.
But,
which, speaking of which, dashiki.
Dashiki!
Yes. And that came about in the 70s and 60s with the Black Panther movement to show the power of where we're from. Where, you know, African, we should be proud of our roots. Muhammad Ali did the same thing. When Malcolm X went back to Africa, he even did a demure version of a dashiki to say, we're proud of our country we're coming from. And it can be not just our country, our continent.
Yes.
This is the modern day.
Yes. This. Okay. Can
Do you know this?
This?
Yes, you can.
This.
And this is girl. This is her prom dress that she wore a few years ago.
She
is a designer. So you can get your own.
Okay.
But this is an interpretation of how that looks today.
Doing it. And
to
then
the
last but
level.
Not least, I know you have to put in some animal print.
Yeah, I do.
I know that is historical.
I do. So originally the Egyptians couldn't, leopard leopards were so rare they couldn't catch them to actually wear them. So the royalty actually painted onto silk the leopard print. So they could feel royal and special, and it's just come into our culture. Same with furs and hats and all of that. And it comes from the working class of Black Americans at the time, where they were always in a uniform, and it shifted into church, right? So it was the church hats. We got to be extravagant because the whole week we were wearing a uniform.
That's right.
And then we showed up and showed out and peacocked a little on Sunday.
That's right. That's so, exactly how it went. And
yeah,
that's
how it went. And I just want to show, this is my peacock. This is my grandmother. And I did a book of church hats, and I got it printed up because in all the pictures that go with it where she's wearing the church hat, I just thought it was important to honor her and honor that culture.
I love that you did this.
Yeah, because
this
a lot of
amazing.
These hats reflect African culture and history.
I can't
history,
wait to
so.
Look through this. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
This was a great history lesson.
Oh, it was so fun. I totally nerded out.
Oh, man. You did your work. Okay, well, we're going to have this information and more about Robin for you on our website at katu.com. Don't go away. We'll be right back with more Afternoon Live after this. This is so cool.